Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup by People's Dispatch, where we bring you major news developments from around the world. Our headlines: Donald Trump's plan to remove humanitarian cover for 300,000 immigrants gets court approval. US whistleblower's complaint alleges medical neglect and forced hysterectomies at ICE detention center. Israeli terrorist responsible for 2015 West Bank attack sentenced to life imprisonment. Kenyan frontline workers win insurance cover against pandemic, but protests continue. And Japan's new Prime Minister is set to continue Abe-era policies. We begin today's report with an update on the COVID-19 pandemic. Over 29.4 million cases have been reported as of today afternoon, with more than 932,000 fatalities. Over 242,000 of these cases were added yesterday alone, of which nearly 82,000 came from India. Among these are at least 17 lawmakers who tested positive as India's parliament session began. Countries across the world are dealing with the pain of trying to reopen, as well as fresh outbreaks. From the Victoria state in Australia to the Netherlands, various parts of the world have reported fresh outbreaks of various degrees. Meanwhile, speculation continues about the fate of one or many vaccines that are destined to save us. Reports indicate a version could be ready by the end of this year or the beginning of the next one, but it remains unclear how long it will be before the vaccine actually gets to a large enough number of people. What we do know is that this phase of life is not ending anytime soon. In our next story, a federal appeals court in the United States has approved the Donald Trump administration's decision to end humanitarian protection to over 300,000 immigrants. On Monday, the U.S. Ninth Circuit Appeals Court in California overruled two standing injunctions by federal district court judges of the government's move. Between 2017 and 18, the Trump administration had ended the Temporary Protected Status, or the TPS. This was a humanitarian protection granted by the U.S. Department of Homeland Security, or the DHS, to these migrants. TPS protected undocumented migrants and asylum seekers coming from countries hit by major political crisis and violence. The appeals court on Monday cleared the termination of TPS for El Salvador, Haiti, and Nicaragua and Sudan. This could pave the way for eventual deportation of hundreds of thousands of undocumented migrants within the U.S., some of whom have held TPS for nearly two decades. Separate lawsuits are ongoing by TPS beneficiaries of other countries whose facility was terminated. The earlier injunctions by federal judges in San Francisco and New York were passed on the basis of President Trump's racially disparaging statements on multiple occasions. In one such public meeting, he referred to the countries from where TPS beneficiaries hail as shithole countries, which was widely condemned as racist and prejudicial. The National TPS Alliance, a group representing plaintiffs in the case, expressed their dismay and will be appealing to a higher court. On the same day, a whistleblower's complaint claimed that detainees held by the U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement, or ICE, were put through dangerous medical practices. A complaint was filed at the Office of the Inspector General of the DHS by Don Wooten, who worked as a nurse at a private detention facility managed by ICE in Georgia. According to Wooten, the private company La Salle Corrections refused detainees COVID-19 care and handled any case of infection with negligence. The complainant filed with the help of civil rights groups stated that the facility was also underreporting COVID-19 cases by refusing testing to inmates. Furthermore, Wooten also alleged that the company she has spoken to several inmates who complained about unwarranted hysterectomies on them. According to her, the company employs an out-of-station doctor to conduct such procedures on inmates complaining of heavy menstrual bleeding or pain. The facility in question, the Irwin County Detention Facility, holds more than 1,000 inmates. In our next story, 5 years after the killing of three members of a Palestinian family by Israeli settlers, a court on Monday passed three life sentences against the main perpetrator. On July 31, 2015, extremist Israeli settler Amiram Ben Uliel firebombed the Tawab Sheikh family home in occupied West Bank village of Duma using Molotov cocktails. The firebombing virtually burned down the house and killed three members of the family, including an 18-month-old infant, Ali Tawab Sheikh. Ali's mother and father, Riham and Saad, later succumbed to their wounds in hospital. The sole survivor in the attack was 4-year-old Ahmed, who ended up with severe burn injuries. Ben Uliel was convicted in May this year on 3 counts of murder and 2 counts of attempted murder. In addition to the 3 life sentences, he has been awarded 40 more years in prison for other criminal charges for which he was convicted, including conspiracy to commit a hate crime. However, he was acquitted of the charge of belonging to a terrorist organization, despite him being a member of Hilltop Youth. This is a Jewish extremist and ultranationalist group known for perpetrating hate and violent crimes against Palestinians. One of Ben Uliel's accomplices, who was a minor at the time of the attack, was convicted of being a member of the terrorist organization, as well as of conspiracy to carry out the arson attack. This accomplice has struck a plea deal with the prosecutors and is expected to be sentenced on Wednesday. Protests by healthcare workers continue even as the National Cabinet has finally approved COVID-19 insurance for all frontline workers in Kenya on Friday. Various sections of the country's public health workers have been taking out strikes, go-slow protests and demonstration over the past few weeks. Earlier, the countrywide strike of nurses, which was supposed to start on Friday, was deferred to October 1st. The Kenya National Union of Nurses, or the KNUN, has stated that the deferment was done to give the government more time to address their grievances. Among the many grievances of medical professionals was the lack of medical cover. Due to this, many of the over 800 medical professionals who have contracted the virus have had to pay out of their pockets for their treatment. Of the more than 16 healthcare workers who have died, none were compensated, according to the union. Striking workers also pointed out that despite calls for comprehensive training to deal with the pandemic, only 21% of the nurses received any training. The strike was being organized under the banner of the Kenya Healthcare Professional Society, an umbrella group that consists of the KNUN and other associations. Apart from insurance, demands include paid leave for those with health risks to COVID-19 exposure, a health risk allowance during the period of the pandemic, hiring an additional 10,000 health workers to address shortages, and a fair deal for contractual workers. While the national strike has been postponed, actions by healthcare professionals in various counties continue on issues such as PPEs, promotion and wages. And finally, Japan's ruling Conservative Liberal Democratic Party, or the LDP, has chosen the successor for outgoing Prime Minister Shinzo Abe. This happened on Monday. The LDP leadership vote returned Yoshihide Suga as a clear winner, winning 377 of the total 534 delegate votes. The leadership vote was necessitated after Abe filed his resignation from prime ministership last month, citing deteriorating health. The largely pro-Abe leadership opted for a close vote among elected officials of the party instead of an open popular vote among its 1 million members. This favoured Suga, while the liberally inclined and pro-peace Shigeru Ishiba, who surveys judged to be more popular among party members, was relegated to a distant third. 71-year-old Suga has been serving as a chief cabinet secretary under Abe since 2012. And was a close aide of the Prime Minister. After he takes over the Prime Minister's office on September 16th, he'll be expected to follow in Abe's economic and foreign policy lines. Suga is also a member of the right-wing Nippon Kaigi, like Abe, and a majority of LDP ministers and legislators. Nippon Kaigi is an anti-left and anti-feminist group that advocates for revising history textbooks to take out Japanese war crimes committed during the Second World War. Suga is also expected to continue Abe-era's support for Nippon Kaigi's agenda to delete Article 9 of the Japanese Constitution that prohibits a standing military and prevents Japan from declaring war. That's all we have time for today. We'll be back tomorrow with more news from around the world. Until then, keep watching People's Dispatch.